for just a few minutes. Genesis chapter 25. Let me do some reading here to get you where I want you to be. And we're not going to be long this evening. Genesis chapter 25, verse 1. It says, Then Abraham took a wife, and her name was Keturah. And she bare him Zimran and Joshan and Medan, Midian, Ishbak, and Shua. And Joshan begat Sheba and Dadan, and the sons of Dadan were Sur, Tushim, and Uman. And the sons of Midian, Ephah, Hannah, Abida, Ether, all these were the children of Keturah. If you didn't study God's word, you would know that Abraham had another wife, but he did. Mm-hmm. After Sarah died, he took another wife. Amen. And Abraham gave all that he had unto Isaac, which was the child of promise, right? But unto the sons of the concubines which Abraham had, Abraham gave gifts and sent them away from Isaac his son, while he yet lived peaceful unto the east country. And these are the days of the years of Abraham's life which he lived, 135 years. Then Abraham gave up the ghost and died out of the good old age, an old man and full of years, was gathered to his people. And his sons, Isaac and Ishmael, buried him in the cave of Pelah in the field of Ephraim, the son of Zor the Hittite, which is before Mount. The field which Abraham purchased of the sons of Heth, there was Abraham buried, and Sarah his wife. And it came to pass after the death of Abraham that God blessed his son Isaac, and Isaac dwelt by the well of Haran. Now these are the generations of Ishmael, Abraham's son, whom Hagar, the Egyptian Sarah's handmaid, bare to Abraham. And these are the names of the sons of Ishmael by their names according to their generation, firstborn of Ishmael, Nebajot, and Kedar, Adbel, and Mishpah, Mipsam. Mishpah, Numah, Massa, Adar, Timah, Tur, Naphish, Kedemah. These are the sons of Ishmael, and these are their names by their towns and by their castles, 12 princes according to their nations. You don't have to worry about reading any more names. Amen. And these are the years of the life of Ishmael, 137 years, and he gave up the ghost and died, and was gathered unto his people. And they dwelt from Havilah to Shur, that is toward Egypt, as thou goest toward Syria. And he died in the presence of all his brethren. And these are the generations of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham got Isaac. And Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Abdullah the Syrian, of Padam, the sister to Laban the Syrian. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren. And the Lord entreated him, and Rebekah his wife conceived. And the children, notice this, struggled together within her. And she said, if it be so, why am I thus? And she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. The one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger. Remember that? And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. And the first came out red, all over like a hairy garment, and they called his name Esau. And after that came his brother out, and his head took hold on Esau's heel. Remember that? And his name was called Jacob, and Isaac was 80 years old when she bare them. And the boys grew, and Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field, and Jacob was a plain man, dwelling in tents. And Isaac loved Esau because he did eat of his venison, but Rebekah loved Jacob. This does not mean they hated the other. And Jacob sought pottage, and Esau came from the field when he was faint, and he was faint. And Esau said to Jacob, feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I am faint. Therefore was his name called Edom. And Jacob said, sell me this day thy birthright. Don't forget that part. And Esau said, behold, I am at the point to die, and what profit shall this birthright do to me? And Jacob said, swear to me this day. And he swore unto him, and he sold his birthright unto Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage and lentils, and he did eat and drink, and rose up and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. Hmm. We've been looking at the danger of silent frustration. how they can be both detrimental and at the same time destructive, how they can cause tumult and treacherousness to go on around us, how they can be sinister and can be solid. All of us as Christians, we will encounter or deal with periods of frustration in our life. We've been looking at individuals in the Bible who dealt with some manner of frustration or disappointment. Remember, this word frustration means disappointed. Sometimes we are so disappointed or frustrated, Jennifer, we want to just run out in the middle of ABF parking lot, amen, and just scream. But as a child of God, I hope we're going to do that, amen. But notice in Genesis chapter 25, again at verse number 25, it says, and the first came out all over, came out red all over like an hairy garment. They called his name Esau. And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold on Esau's heel. It seemed that even in the womb, he was tormenting his brother, always trying to hold him back. Amen. You ever been in a situation in your life where it seemed like somebody's trying to grab hold to your heel, trying to keep you from achieving something, trying to hold you back? I know that Esau had no idea, concept of what was going on, but later on in life, this will play an important role as his brother, Jacob, set out to hold him back. So here they are, even in the womb. He come out, he grabbed hold of his heel, and his name was called Jacob. Isaac was 80 years old, she buried him, and the boys grew. Now they got to realize these boys born as twins, and now they are growing up into boyhood. Then they grow up into manhood. I don't doubt that Jacob, throughout their life, was always making a move toward Esau, his older brother. It says Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field, and Jacob was a plain man, dwelling in tents. And Isaac loved Esau because he did eat of his bison. But Rebekah loved Jacob. Now don't get this confused and think that they did not love their other son. It's simply saying that they had a preference between these boys. Parents, we have to be careful about how we show our preference. We love them all the same way. You said, Brother Bishop, how do you say that, and how do we love them all the same way, yet have a preference? We love them what I call unconditional. Love your children, man. Unconditional. If you favor something one does, a talent or something like that, or another, that's okay. But love them all equally. How? Unconditionally. Children are different. They need to be handled differently. You can't punish them all the same way. You can't reward them all the same way. What one child may call punishment, another child may call a reward. You got a child who's an introvert, they love to read and be by themselves. Both of them get in trouble. You tell the one that loves to be by themselves and reading, you go to your room. The other child likes to be outside, playing all the time, running wild. You tell them to go to their room. Which one is being punished? You ain't punishing both of them. You think you're punishing both of them. So we have to look at our children and recognize that there are differences in them. However, when it comes to love, it must be unconditional. I don't love you because you're smarter than Stu. I don't love you because you're better in sports. I love you both, or all of you, from where I come from. Amen. Unconditional. Am I right about it? So here are these two boys. And it says in verse number 29, verse 28, and Isaac loved Esau because he did eat his bison, but Rebekah loved Jacob. And Jacob sighed pottage. Now watch this. Esau came from the field. He was faint. Esau said to Jacob, feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, for I am faint. Therefore was his name called Edom. And Jacob said, sell me this day thy birthright. He said, sell me thy birthright. And this is not just what we call in jest, amen. This is not just saying, hey man, I'm just playing with you. I'm just throw something out there and see if you bite on it. Jacob has something in mind. So he says to his brother, sell me thy birthright. He didn't say, sell me your favorite jacket, amen. He didn't say, sell me your favorite bowling ball, amen. He says, sell me your birthright. He was very specific about what he was trying to acquire from his brother. So he says, sell me this day thy birthright. And in verse 32, and Esau said, behold, I am at the point to die. Now, I've been hungry before, and you've been hungry before. But ain't many of us probably been hungry to the point that we thought we were going to die, amen. Somebody's going to feed you, amen. Somebody somewhere is going to give you something to eat. But he said, I am to the point to die, and what profit shall this birthright, remember that, do to me? And Jacob said, swear to me this day, and he swore unto him, and he sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage and lentils, and he did eat and drink, and rose up and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. You have to understand, in a moment of frustration, in a moment of disappointment, we sometimes do things that we otherwise wouldn't do. And there are people who may set out to take advantage of us because in a moment of disappointment or a moment of frustration, we may answer in a way that we normally, when we're thinking clearly, we wouldn't answer. So Esau gave no thought to what he said. And it's not saying that later on, in verse 34, it's not saying later on through life, he despised his birthright. It's simply saying that at that moment, what he did was a sign or an example of despising his birthright. Esau experienced frustration at the hand of his brother, Jacob. And this lesson, silent frustrations, will you despise your birthright? Will you despise your birthright? What are you talking about, preacher? Watch this as I close it. The frustration of Esau clouded his way of thinking. Did he think that his act was non-binding? You know how somebody they come to you trying to make a deal or something, and you just kind of, yeah, whatever. But you have no intention of holding up to that deal? You have no intention of honoring that deal, and you may even be so lost savvy that you recognize that that deal will not even hold up in court. You don't realize that if someone signs a contract and they're not 18 years old, then that contract is non-binding. Why do you think when you read something that says, are you at least 18? You're 17 years old, you can sign that thing. Don't mean that thing. Because in a court of law, it will not hold up. So here's Esau, he's challenged, he's asked to sell his birthright, and in a moment of weakness, because remember he said he's about to die. And in his mind, maybe he felt that way. But in this moment, with his thinking clouded, he said, man, take this birthright. What's this birthright going to do for me? I'm home, I need something to eat now. So he sells his birthright. But did he think it would be non-binding? Did he think it would be void in a court of law? His motivation for a temporal fix. Now watch this, and this is what gets us sometimes, brothers and sisters. A temporal fix. Too many times we're willing to trade our soul salvation, a life of eternity with God, for a temporary fix. For a moment of pleasure, too many times Christians are willing to sell their entire birthright. Because of his frustration, he jeopardized his inheritance. Esau parted with his rightful place on his birthright that was a blessing. Man, don't give up your blessings. Hold on to your blessings. Your blessings from God, don't give them up so easily. What are you talking about, preacher? The birthright was a blessing. The birthright entitled someone to a double inheritance from the father. Under that culture, you have to understand that this was significant. The birthright. Why do you think Jacob was was in such a adamant about receiving it. He and his mama. It had meaning to it, amen. But see, God had already said that the elder will serve the younger. So here we are once again, somebody trying to help God do this work. Before those boys were born, God said there's two manner of men in your womb. The elder will serve the younger. You realize what he's saying there? This thing is already set. But mama gonna try to help along, right? And then, throughout time, mama's teaching that boy that, hey, God said, you are going to be over your older brother. So what is he saying in his mind? I gotta figure out how to make this happen. But God already said it's gonna happen. We have to take God at his word.
Amen.
And these are people who are talking directly to God. They're still not taking him at his word. But fast forward to us. How often do we take God at his word? How often, as Christians, when we read God's word, do we take him at his word? So here's the situation. The birthright entitled one to a double inheritance from the Father. We stand to lose salvation, two huge things, amen, and eternal life with the Father. When you and I give up, when we give away or give up our birthright, we stand to lose eternal life, we stand to lose our soul salvation. And what should it profit me if I gain the whole world and lose my own soul? Don't be willing to give up the birthright. Man. Don't allow frustrations and disappointments and things that take place in your life to cause you to give up your birthright. What are you talking about, preacher? Let's look at this birthright. This birthright, once again, it entitles one to a double inheritance from the Father. What do we stand to lose? We stand to lose salvation and eternal life with the Father. Now, we would never, I know this, right, do something as foolish as what Esau did. We would never be guilty of anything like that, would we? Every time 1 John 1:7 says, walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ continually cleanses us. Every time we step outside the light, we have just tossed aside our birthright. We're giving it up. We allow things to frustrate us in this life that is going to cause us to lose our eternal birthright, our eternal soul salvation, our eternal inheritance. Every time we fall short of God's glory, there's one more opportunity for us to sell our inheritance, to sell our birthright. And don't act like it don't happen to us. Amen. Because we are battling sin every day. And Paul said, man, don't think it's strange. He said, don't think it's strange in 1 Peter chapter 4. When the darts of the devil are coming your way, when you're having problems, when you're going through things, don't think it's strange. But know this, don't give up. Don't toss away your birthright. Don't give up your inheritance. What inheritance are you talking about, preacher? As I close here in Acts chapter 20, talk about our inheritance. In Acts chapter 20, but this inheritance here is the greatest inheritance. You know, everybody secretly, in the back of their mind, maybe just Brother Bishop. Secretly in the back of Brother Bishop's mind, he always believes he's going to have some long lost uncle somewhere. You thought about that too? Sam thought about that too. This long lost uncle just going to show up, but now he's not going to show up. Some attorney going to show up one day. So, are you Larry Bishop? Yes, sir, I am. He said, well, I have some bad news and I have some good news. Bad news, your great, great, great uncle so and so, he died. The good news is, amen, you inherit Y'all would see them smoke out there on that parking lot. No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't leave. I like to think I would leave. I know we go to work tomorrow. Well, I will go pick up my stuff. Kind of like when y'all play that lottery. Y'all be able to tell people, man, like, if I'm showing tomorrow, that's a big number hit up there. I think if you're up there 400 million, y'all be telling people to work, man, if I'm showing tomorrow, you know how to hit. We don't play the lottery. We don't play the lottery, okay? We should not be playing the lottery. We don't want those riches. Amen? Go out and work. May God for health and strength and grace your mind. Go out and work. Amen. It may take some longer than others, but still, go out and do what?
Work.
Work. You'll appreciate things more. Amen. I guess my thing about they take it now. In Acts chapter 20, we talk about our inheritance. Verse 20, it said, take heed therefore unto yourselves, unto all the flock, over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which you have purchased with his own blood. Paul says, for I know this, that after my departing, shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. He says, therefore watch, and remember that by the space of 3 years, I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. And now, brethren, Paul says, I commend you to God, to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance. This is what I want, y'all. When all is said and done, this is what I want. An inheritance among all them which are sanctified. That's what we're working for, amen. We're not working just so folks can say, at our funeral, that was a good brother. That was a dear one, sister. They're going to be so missed. I'm not working just to hear folks say that in my funeral. Amen. I'm working to receive an inheritance among all those that are sanctified. Talking about birthright. Acts chapter 26, verse 14 says, and Acts 26, 14 says, and when we were falling asleep, and we were all falling to the earth, I remember a voice speaking unto me. This is Paul recounting his conversion. I mean, his account with Jesus, not his conversion, his account with Jesus. And said in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It's hard for thee to kick this quick. And I said, who art thou, Lord? He said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. But rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make you a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen, and of those things in which I will appear unto thee. Deliver thee from the people, from the Gentiles, unto whom now I send thee, to open their eyes and turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and what? Inheritance. Talk about our birthright. Among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. We're talking about a birthright here. We're talking about our inheritance, and we're not going to give it up. We're not going to allow situations and things of life to frustrate us so much that we throw away our inheritance or our birthright. Amen. Ephesians 1, verse 11. Ephesians 1, verse 11 says, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. Drop down to verse 14 where it says, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. Remember that word, inheritance and birthright, and how they go together. Remember, the eldest child was entitled to a double portion. As a child of God, we have afforded us, offered to us, a double portion. We have salvation from our sins. We have life eternal with the Father. Mm-hmm. Colossians chapter 1, verse 12 says, giving thanks unto the Father which have made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who have delivered us from the power of darkness and have translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. A lot of thought went into this. Amen. A lot of thought went into this whole concept. And a lot of thought went into what God was doing with Jacob and Esau. He had already told Jacob's mother, the younger shall serve the elder. That birthright, it was coming to Jacob. It was already part of God's plan. Esau, because of his frustrations, he was willing to just give it up, to just cast it aside. Colossians 3:24 says, knowing that of the Lord you should receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Jesus Christ. And as I close here, 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1 says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. He led according to the foreknowledge of God, followed through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance. Suppose that great, great, great uncle that you never knew did come along, or that attorney came along and said, you know, you are the sole survivor, or you are the sole heir of your great, great uncle, whoever, his estate, and he gave you that $100 million. What an inheritance. And you go out and decide to invest it in lottery tickets. I'm about $100 million lottery ticket. And you lose it all. It's gone. Now all the friends you had yesterday when you found out Sam, they gone too. And all those plans that you had for tomorrow, Brother Jones, they gone too. Why? Because it is corruptible. But what I'm talking about here is an inheritance that is incorruptible. It's undefiled and it fades not away. How can you say that, preacher? Because it is reserved in heaven.
Amen.
Don't throw away your birthright. Don't give up your inheritance like Esau for a morsel of food, something like that, for a piece of food. Something to satisfy the flesh. It just adds credence to the idea or the thought that three things get us: lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and pride of life. That flesh was lusty. Because of the lust of the flesh, he was willing to sell his birthright. Because of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life, sometimes, brothers and sisters, we are willing to sell our birthright. But I want us to be like Moses. When it speaks of Moses in Hebrews chapter 11, he says he was not willing to endure sin, the pleasures of sin for a season. I'm not willing to endure the pleasures of sin for a season. It's only temporary, it's corruptible, and it's going to go away. But heaven, it's forever. Heaven is for always. Amen. We talk about things eternal. We talk about an inheritance and our reward being in heaven. Fight those frustrations. Deal with those frustrations. They are dangerous. Disappointments are dangerous to our existence. Are they going to come? Well, we best believe they're going to come. So how do we deal with them? Can I give away our inheritance? No, we don't deal with them that way. We overcome them. And as a child of God, there's nothing that can be put on you that God can't move from. Mm-hmm. That's the God we serve. Amen. Overcoming your frustrations. Will you despise your birthright? I pray that your answer is, Brother Bishop, I won't sell my birthright. I won't give up my inheritance, but lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, and fire of life. Let that not be us. I want to see you in heaven, amen?
Amen.
I want to see you in heaven. I want you to stand before God and before Jesus here and say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. That's my prayer for you this evening. That's my prayer for us all. If you're here tonight, you're not a child of God, You become a child of God through obedience to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus died on the cross for better. He rose again the third day. You feel that story, you have to be willing to believe it. Have a change of mind, which is repentance. You're willing to confess it to the Son of God. Then you have your sins washed away in water, by baptism. You rise to walk in this life. You add to the body of Christ, the church of Christ. He says, rise to life. He is coming back for her. Revelation 2:10 tells us, be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life. Don't you want your mansion? Don't you want your gold? Don't you want your crown? God, I'm going to deal with frustrations. They can be dangerous to us. They can be detrimental. They can be destructive. If you're tonight, you're not a child of God, then it's your prayer. If you're tonight, you're a child of God, you need prayer for yourself. Someone else that's going to take out and say thank you. May God help. Make that known to you, stand and sing the song to you.
Number 922. I hear my Savior say, thy friend.